Hey, thanks for checking out the first episode of The Educated Pour, a show dedicated to demystifying the vast world of beer, wine, and liquor. Along the way, we'll show you how to enjoy a good drink without breaking the bank. On today's episode, we'll explore the oldest known alcoholic drink, beer. Let's grab a cold one. Drink smart, drink well. Cheers. Beer, the world's most widely consumed alcoholic beverage and third most popular drink overall after water and tea. It comes in all sorts of sizes and comes from various places around the world. You may know about the drinking culture, surrounded by games involving cheap beer and solo cups, a culture that spreads beyond college dorm walls into the global competitive world of drinking. But there's an entire world of microbrews and craft beers to be enjoyed. But how did it all start? Let's take a look. The Educated Pour presents The Brief History of Beer. Scholars believe that we went from a hunter and gatherer culture to a settled agriculture existence in order to have enough grain to make beer. Recipes have been found on clay tablets and art in Mesopotamia that show individuals using straws to drink beer from large vats and pots, which today we all know as the first beer bong. The Code of Hammurabi included laws regulating beer and beer parlors. The Hymn of Ninkasi, a prayer to the Mesopotamian goddess of beer, served as both a prayer and as a method of remembering the recipe for beer. In ancient Egypt, if a man gave a sip of his beer to a lady, they were considered engaged. In Europe during the Middle Ages, a document of the times mentions nuns having an allowance of 6 pints of ale a day. Queen Elizabeth was known for substituting beer for orange juice in the morning.
Why, this is quite good. What do you think, Senor?
A magnificent gift! It just makes me feel guilty that all we brought along was the smallpox.
Smallpox, not a good gift.
The pilgrims originally were set to go to Virginia, but due to bad storms and beer supplies being low, they stopped in Massachusetts, drank all day because it was safer than water. A beer recipe was found in George Washington's notebook. During the Revolutionary War, he made sure that there was a quart of beer per soldier per day.
So the most strategic spot to build a brewery would be right here at Fort Pitt.
Yeah, so who's gonna build it? 1, 2, 3.
Not it!
Balls.
Adolphus Busch pioneered the use of double-walled railcars and a network of ice houses to make Budweiser the first national brand. In 1909, Teddy Roosevelt took 500 gallons of beer on an African safari. No wonder he was so happy all the time.
But then came the darkest part of beer history.
After Prohibition, Budweiser delivered their first case of beer to President Roosevelt.
You know, John, I was thinking, let's put beer in a can.
Yes, brilliant, because when I think good beer, my taste buds crave metal.
And one day, every man, woman, and child will know the name Kruger.
Who?
In World War II, brewers were required to allocate 15% of their production for military use. In the last half of the century, advertising became an integral part of not only sales, but our popular culture.
So what's up, B?
All right, for our first episode, we're going to be checking out the full range of beer flavors. So what we have today is 5 beers, ranging from light to a dark stout. So we've got a light beer here, we've got a wheat beer,
a little bit darker, moving on to an IPA, a brown ale, and like again I said, a stout. So we're going to taste test from the lightest to the darkest, just to kind of get your palate adjusted to new beers. Alright, the first beer we'll be tasting is an American light beer, Bud Light. If you want to taste along, you can also do any other American light lager, such as a Coors Light or a Miller Light. So let's taste this. So what you're going to be tasting is a very, very mild beer, very subtle hop flavor, very crisp, very drinkable. So this is the kind of beer that you might want to drink throughout a night, as opposed to maybe one or two. Alright, let's check out the next beer. Alright, right here we have a wheat beer, a Hefeweizen. If you notice, you can tell right away it's a little bit darker. It's actually really cloudy because it's unfiltered. Let's take a taste. Right off the bat, you can kind of taste a little bit of subtle orange peel, a little bit of fruit flavor. That's why a lot of times if you order a wheat beer at a bar, you may see it garnished with an orange slice or some lemon. This is a great beer. If you want to try tasting a wheat beer, popular ones are Blue Moon, Polliner, or the one today we're tasting, UFO. Alright, let's check out the next one. It's called an India Pale Ale, or an IPA. Right off the bat, you can see there's a big difference between the color of this one and the previous two. Nice copper, amber kind of color to it. Let's take a taste. This one, the big thing you're looking for is the floral characteristic of it. You're getting that from the hops that are added to this. A lot more hoppiness, a lot more alcohol involved in it. So a little bit more body to it. All right, next one we have up, a brown ale. Just like the ones before, just a little bit darker. And this one you're gonna be looking for more of a sweet taste to it, very malty, a little bit more body to it. So for new drinkers to beer, this might be a little bit too dark for you, but try it out. Very good, very sweet. Not something you want to be drinking over and over throughout the night. Maybe one or two. Okay, so we've come to our darkest of the beers, the stout. Now, right off the bat, you can easily see that this is a lot darker than the Bud Light, of course. Now, what you're going to be looking for in the stout is a very kind of like coffee taste to it, chocolatey, maybe even a little bit of vanilla. A lot more body to this beer than any of the previous beers. Now, don't confuse that for alcohol content, because you'd be surprised, something like a stout like this might be lower in alcohol content than something way lighter in color. Let's take a taste. Very dark. There's a lot of roasted malt flavor to it. Now, if you want to taste along, I suggest you get a Guinness. It's the most popular stout out there. And it's probably the best way to get into stouts because it's not too heavy. What's great about it is they actually inject a little bit of nitrogen into it to kind of give it that really creamy flavor. Now obviously we've only tasted 5 beers here today, but there are dozens upon dozens of different styles out there, and hundreds of breweries that do each style a little bit differently. So if there's anything that you tasted here today that you didn't like, don't be afraid to try that same style from a different brewery. So happy drinking, and as always, cheers!
What's the use of getting sober when you're gonna get drunk again?
You know, John, I was thinking, let's put beer in a can.
Yes, brilliant, because I think...